Good morning.
Good morning.
If you're joining us online, please bring your own Christ candle and we'll light them together. In the bulletin, responses in bold are spoken in unison. And when there's an asterisk, please stand if you can. Welcome to our first bluegrass worship service. Announcements. We'll have choir practice on Wednesday, and if you want to have as much fun as you're having this morning, come on Wednesday. That's at 7 o'clock. We're also collecting DVDs to donate to Bethany Rehab Center and Mercy Homes for their movie nights. Greta said they only had, you know, like three or four, and they had to keep watching the same thing over and over. Not only can you go through your stack and see what you're not really using anymore, but Edmondson Pike Library has DVDs on sale for $1 each. Now, they have to be G, PG, or PG-13. We don't want to get too much excitement here. Anything else about that, Greta? Okay. Any other announcements?
I want to thank everyone who came yesterday. It was a lot, and a lot of you were, what we're talking about, for those of you who weren't here, is the neighborhood meeting about our plans and introducing that to the neighborhood. And a lot of you sent me texts, gave hugs, and I needed every bit of it, and I thank you very much for that. I will be gone this next week. I'm leaving this afternoon, be back next late next Sunday night, and back in the office on the 24th. Reverend Carrie Frazier, who has been here before, is going to preach for me next Sunday. Wednesday night, Greta is hosting our Southminster Pub Party at Black Abbey Brewery at 6:15, so don't make Greta drink alone. Come have a beer with her. and I think that's it, unless somebody has... Yes, Judy has an announcement, and I'm excited to hear it.
I want to tell you about a lady named Kristen Shell. Kristen and her family moved to Austin, Texas more than 10 years ago, and she was getting settled in her neighborhood. She was missing her old friends, but she needed to make new friends in her new neighborhood. So she started thinking, I can host a party, but that means scheduling. And that means grocery shopping, and that means cleaning the house and the bathroom and not knowing who all will show up. And she looked out her back window and she decided, well, I can do this in my backyard. Only thing was, she didn't have any outside furniture. So she got online and she ordered 2 picnic tables from Lowe's. And the next day, the truck came and offloaded the tables, although the men offloaded one of the tables in her front yard. So she went on to have the party, and she was pleased with how the neighbors responded. But she looked out at that table, and she decided, it needs to be painted, and I'm going to paint it my favorite color, turquoise. So she did. And she set it out under a tree, close to the sidewalk in her front yard. And she talked to the kids about it, and she said, let's let the neighbors know why this table's here. So they would go out and take their coloring books or their crafts or their reading books and just sit at the table. She would take out her study Bible or just a cup of tea and sit at the table. And soon people started coming by and looking at them. A construction worker came in and said, Is it okay if I have my lunch here? Sure, you're welcome. And another lady came down the street pushing a baby in a stroller, and she said, is it okay if I sit down here and rest? And she did. And so that began the movement of the turquoise table that became the front yard people, offering people in the community a place where they could find a place of community and love and acceptance with no strings attached. At this point, there are 50 states and 13 countries that are involved in this movement. So you ask, what has that got to do with Southminster? Well, if you happen to come in the back door of the fellowship hall, there's a very old and much used in the past picnic table. And some people have tried to just write that table off. But there's some in the crowd here that think that it still has some life left in it. And they want to paint it turquoise and put it out in our yard and let our neighbors know that we are a loving community and we want to reach out and have a place where they can come and just sit and be quiet or get to know who's sitting at their table. So I encourage you to watch your newsletter and your weekly announcements as they come out, and you'll see updates on that. And watch for how things progress here. We'll have access to the national media where our table and pictures of our table can be posted on the website. So it's a fun, exciting, low-key opportunity to reach out to our neighbors. Thanks.
Thank you, Judy. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
As you may have noticed as you came in, it's Bluegrass Sunday. Bethany and Forrest and Nyssa, the choir, we have had a great time practicing and preparing for it, and we are hoping your spirits are encouraged and it makes you smile today. Also, we're going to continue our series of How I Got Here with Amber Lewis Stewart. And those who we've heard from before, Greta and Blake, their stories have touched us and helped us to see more light in our world, and I think that will happen also when we hear from Amber. So let's worship together.
Join me in the call of worship and opening prayer. Let our praise for all that God has done resound within and beyond these walls. When all people turn to God and worship God, the poor shall eat and be satisfied. And justice and peace will surely embrace present and future generations. Therefore, in thanksgiving for all that God has done, let our lives and our love proclaim the message of God's gracious and liberating acts. We too cry out in praise and thanksgiving in response to God, to God's hearing. Your eternal loving kindness holds us, guides us, and enfolds us with grace. As we gather as your people, we pray that our worship will reflect your divine love. We offer our worship today with a remembrance of your faithfulness, filling us with joy and firing our devotion. Let our praise for all that you have done, are doing, and will do truly resound within our hearts and our homes, within these walls and beyond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. please remain standing for the prayer of confession and assurance of forgiveness. When we gather to praise God, we remember that we are people who have preferred our wills to His. Accepting God's power to make us new in Christ, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful One, You know when we are afraid to love. You know when we are too cowardly to show mercy. Remind us again that perfect love casts out such fears. Surround us and strengthen us with Your perfect love. Imbue us with a love so strong, with such growth toward perfection, that we may cast aside our pride and embrace the power of love. While it is true that we have sinned, it is a greater truth that we are forgiven through God's love in Jesus Christ. To all who seek the mercy of God, I say, in Jesus Christ your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I need all sorts of notes. Let's pray for illumination before we read the scriptures. Eternal God, in the reading of the scripture, may your word be heard. In the meditations of our hearts, may your word be known. And in the faithfulness of our lives, may your word be shown. Amen. Our first scripture is from Psalms chapter 22, verses 25 to 31. I'm reading from the Common English Bible. I offer praise in the great congregation because of you. I will fulfill my promise in the presence of those who honor God. Let all those who are suffering eat and be full. Let all who seek the Lord praise Him. I pray your hearts live forever. Every part of the earth will remember and come back to the Lord. Every family among all the nations will worship you. Because the right to rule belongs to the Lord, He rules the nations. Indeed, all the earth's powerful will worship Him. All who are descending to the dust will kneel before Him. My being also lives for Him. Future descendants shall serve Him. Generations to come will be told about my Lord. They will proclaim God's righteousness to those, telling them what God has done. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
About that good old way.
invite the kids up, because I have some questions for you this morning. Hi, Aaron. Yeah. Come and have a seat. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Oh. All right, have a seat, Aaron. So, good job. Okay. Today is Bluegrass Sunday. We're having all of our music is bluegrass. Why do you think we'd want to do that? Because it's fun. Because we enjoy using bluegrass music to praise and worship God. But I have a question for you. What do you think God does for fun? Well, the first verse in the whole Bible has a clue for us. Genesis 1:1 says this, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." I think that sounds like fun. Can you imagine how much fun it would have been to make stars and mountains or giraffes or platypuses, whatever they are? So much fun. So what is a part of God's creation that you think would have been fun to make? I will start. Kangaroos. I think that would have been really fun. Aaron, what do you think would be fun to make? What? One more time. I can't hear you. Can you talk
about it? I think you said skunks.
Did you say skunks? No? Okay. What kind of animal would you think would be fun to make? A giraffe, big fun, because it could just stretch, so that could be really fun. Eli, what do you think would be fun to make? A rhino? Oh, that would be fun, that horn, yeah. Will, what do you think?
A duck?
Cool. CJ, what about you? What do you think? It's a tough one, I know. There's a lot of creation to think through. A turtle. That would be fun. And Kazi clearly has feelings about what she wants to make. That's awesome. So do you guys ever create stuff? Yeah, you do. I know each of you, maybe with paper or fabric or Legos or Play-Doh. When you create stuff, especially when you have fun creating stuff, you're being like God, which makes sense because the Bible tells us we're made in God's image. We're made to be like God. And creating stuff is one of the ways we can see that we are made in God's image. And I think that when we create stuff and enjoy creating it, I think God smiles. I know that each one of you is very creative and very, very loved by God. Let's have a prayer. Dear God, thank you for making us in your image. And thank you for helping us to create like you. Amen. All right, guys. We'll hang out with Miss Kiana and Miss Katrina. Now I'll invite Amber to come on up here. And we can just sit right here. Can you all see if we sit here? Do you want us to put, can you see? Okay, if you can see, we're good. What?
Oh, are y'all going to be doing it?
Yeah.
Oh. All right.
Okay. This one's yours.
Yes. Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
Great.
Good deal. Okay. Oh, what? Okay. We're scooting to the middle. Okay.
I'm watching here.
Thank you. All right, so, Amber.
Yes.
What is your name and what do you do for a living?
My name is Amber Lewis Stewart, and I work in a family homelessness prevention initiative at the United Way.
All right, what is your title? I'm just throwing that in there.
Manager of Projects and Communications.
Okay. How long have you been at Southminster?
I started coming to Southminster in 2019.
Oh, wow. Okay. How long have you been an elder, and what is your area of church leadership?
This is my third year on session, which seems wild.
Yeah.
And I'm currently on Care of Families, soon to be renamed.
Right.
Still workshopping that one.
So tell us briefly about your faith journey.
Okay, I was trying to figure out how to do this briefly, and I'm not sure I can, but y'all are like literally a captive audience, so we're just gonna do this. So I think the first thing that you need to know in order to understand my faith journey is how big of a role my grandparents played in my life. My mom and my dad divorced when I was a year old. So, you know, I never really knew them together. It's cool, right? Not a big trauma or anything, but my grandparents were around a lot because my mom had custody and she was a single mom, right? And my grandparents were super embedded in the Church of Christ, like super embedded. Which is funny because my grandmother grew up Baptist and my grandfather was just like, on it all until he decided to get back on the straight and narrow. And then he was like, I will only go to a Church of Christ church. And my grandmother was like, well, if it gets him back in church, we're going the whole distance. And so, you know, she committed hard to the Church of Christ. Growing up, we were definitely around the Church of Christ. I went to a Church of Christ school, K through 12. My mom and I kind of went to church, but really didn't start going until I started getting made fun of at my Christian school for not going to church every Sunday. And then we started going to church on Sundays when I was in about second grade. So I was just like really immersed in this world. And, you know, in a lot of ways it was great. You know, we had a strong community. We had, basically everywhere we went, there was like a community to take us in and, you know, take care of us. And my mom, as you all know, she passed away when I was a child, when I was 13. And, you know, kind of the sicker that she got, the more religious she got, right? Which I think, like, the specter of death is, like, want to make us more religious, right? Like, I think that that's a pretty common thing. It just got increasingly more kind of legalistic, more fundamentalist, you know, because, you know, in reaching for something. And that was all fine until she died. And I moved in with my dad and my stepmom. They were Baptist. And, you know, you all who've, you know, grown up in the South know there's a little bit of a thing between the Baptists and the Church of Christ. And, you know, my stepmom's dad was a Baptist preacher. You know, you don't get more Baptist than that. And so I was going to a Church of Christ school and going to a Baptist church. And this is when it all started to fall apart, right? Because everyone was like, I had Church of Christ family members who were threatening to not associate with me anymore if I joined a Baptist church, right? Because the old school Church of Christ believes that they're the only ones who are going to heaven, right? Mm-hmm. So actually at the age of 14, my entire family joined a Baptist church without me. I just did not join with them, which was hard to be kind of separated from my family in that way. And then, you know, when I'm sitting here going, y'all are so into the particulars. Like, what's just, like, we're all talking about the same God, right? Like, it's kind of why I chose the, the passage that I did, because it's all about love, you know? And I just remember being really frustrated and really jaded. And then I decided to move to New York, which, you know, I did mostly because, you know, as I was getting older, I was also discovering that I was queer. And the church either would not or could not make a place for me. Neither one of them. The Baptist church couldn't make room for me, and the Church of Christ would not make room for me. And I was just like, you know, my church didn't want me. The year I turned 18, Tennessee voted to make a marriage between a man and a woman constitutionally. So I was like, my state doesn't want me, my church doesn't want me. I'm just gonna go. So I moved to New York, and when I was there, I just got surrounded by the most diverse group of people you can possibly imagine. And I wasn't going to church. And it wasn't necessarily because I didn't believe in God anymore. It was because I felt like I didn't know if God believed in me anymore. And so eventually, though, I was like, well, I'm going to try something. So I went to a Unitarian Universalist church. And while ultimately that was not my path, I wanted something more grounded in the Christian tradition, I will always be grateful for my time there because they taught me a few things. One, they taught me that diversity is important, right? Inclusivity is important, and that we can learn things from other people, that are people who are not like us. Two, it taught me that a commitment to God is a commitment to social justice. They were a very progressive, very active organization. And three, it taught me that I could potentially have a relationship with God. It might still be a work in progress, but it was a possibility, right? And, and then I like tried a few Christian churches and it didn't really stick, mostly because I was in my early 20s and didn't want to get up on Sunday mornings. and then I moved back to Nashville in 2015 and I was like, you know what? Like, I'm going to try this again. And I ended up at Holy Trinity for a while. Some of you might know Holy Trinity. They have a mostly LGBTQ congregation, which was a really important space for me. But the most important thing that I heard there was I heard a sermon where the preacher said, God is big enough to hold your anger. And I had a lot of it from, you know, everything that had kind of been done to me in the name of the church. And I was like, okay, cool, because like we need room for that if we're going to continue on this relationship. Like, I got to have permission to be mad. And so I was real mad, but I wanted to hang in there and try to just keep acting in the relationship. And anyway, Jamie and I met, we tried a couple of churches, but then I met Beth at Kayla and Blake's birthday party. For those of y'all who don't know, Kayla and I went to high school together. Actually, we went like second grade through high school together. So we had known each other a long time. And I met Beth at Kayla and Blake's joint birthday party, and the rest is history. That was long, I'm sorry, but it was That's important.
Okay. It had a lot of, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
We're glad you landed with us.
Yeah.
What's the best book you've read lately, or the best movie you've seen lately?
Yeah, I read a lot, and I really wanted this to be a book, but I'm not going to lie, I've been reading a lot of, like, really garbage escapist, like, science fiction lately. we'll go with the best movie, which was, Jamie and I went to go see Asteroid City recently in the theaters. It's very good.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is one of your biggest God moments?
I have two.
Okay.
That are kind of equally God moments. I'm really skeptical of these, by the way. Like, it took me a long time to be able to be like, I think that was maybe God. But now, I work in nonprofits, but some of y'all, I know my career started in education, but I at first did not want to be a teacher, y'all. I had gone to art school to study writing. So I have a fine arts degree in writing, and I really just wanted to be an artist, right? An artist and a writer. Unfortunately, I graduated in 2011 in New York, which was very much still in the middle of a recession, and my fine arts degree in writing wasn't taking me very far. So I was working at like PetSmart and was not making ends meet, and was living in a horrible situation, and I was just like, I can't keep living here, and I wasn't ready to come home yet. There was too much unsettled stuff with my family. And so I was like, can I move to like Germany? Like, I was like trying to figure out how to be in the world. And some older friends of mine who I had done some political activism work with were going out of town, and they asked me to watch their two dogs. I was like, yeah, sure, pay me. I'll make money. Like, if I can live in my not terrible apartment and live in your beautiful, like overlooking the Hudson apartment for like a week, yeah, like sign me up. Mm-hmm. And so, but I was still working in Brooklyn, and they lived in Washington Heights. And if any of y'all know New York, that's a very long subway ride. And so I was sitting on the subway, and I looked up, and there was an ad for the New York City Teaching Fellows. And it had never occurred to me to be a teacher. Like, this was so low on my list of things I wanted to do, y'all. Like, it was not even an option. But I was looking at this ad and just like staring at it the whole time. And I was like, well, I could stay in New York. And so I looked it up when I got to their place, and the application was due that day. And I put it in on a whim. I ended up getting accepted. Turns out they only let like 12% of people into this program. And what they do is they pay for you to get a master's in education if you teach 2 years in a Title I school. And so I taught three in a Title I school in Queens. And then that led me K through 12, adult education, nonprofits, you know, and it has basically set the trajectory for an entire career of helping people, because I was desperate and sitting on the subway and saw a sign, literally a sign, like on the subway that was like, this is what you should do. And so, and I'll just like forever be grateful for that moment. The other one is when Jamie and I matched on two different dating apps on the same day.
Ooh, okay. what do you do that is so absorbing that you just lose all track of time?
I do two things. I work on furniture. I refurbish old furniture. And I do embroidery. And both of those things, just working with my hands, mm-hmm. all track of time.
And I think you've answered this to some extent, but how has your faith changed over time?
Yeah, I think when I was younger, God was supposed to be this like parent, but like a loving parent, but really he was being given to me as an abusive parent. You know, mm-hmm. it's like, if you even think about stepping out of line, you're gonna suffer forever. Mm. And that was really hard. Now I think of God, this is again kind of goes back to that love is, you know, God is love passage, which is that I believe God is present in the love that we show each other, right? God is in the way that we move to like concretely show each other how we can make the world better, how we can work toward the reconciliation of all things. Like, and I think that that God is a lot more compelling than a do as I say or else God.
What is one thing about you that people are surprised by?
So I thought about this one a lot because I'm really an open book. Like, you can really just ask me anything. So I thought maybe I'd just use this as like a second to just correct a slight misconception, which is that I don't identify as a lesbian. Like, and I think most people just assume that because I'm in a relationship with a woman and we're married. But I, you'll hear me identify myself as queer a lot. I really like that the most. If you want to get real technical, I identify as a homoromantic bisexual, which is a big mouthful, but essentially means that when I watch Star Wars, I'm really into the way that Han Solo's pants fit, but I really, but I also think that Leia is really attractive. I don't want to spend any time with Han Solo, but I want to like lead the rebel forces with Leia and like cook her dinner afterwards. Okay. So that's, all right. That's what that means.
You putting the cookies on the low shelf there.
Yeah.
Star Wars shelf, right? What are your hopes for Southminster Presbyterian Church?
I really want Southminster to continue to be the haven that it is, but I want us to be louder about it. Mm-hmm. I want, and I think that the housing and the childcare and the coffee shop, I think that's all like a great step. I really love that. But I want people to not be afraid to walk into these doors because they know exactly what they're gonna get when they walk in. Mm-hmm. And because we have lived it so loudly that there's no mystery here.
Mm-hmm. Briefly tell us about your all-time favorite road trip memory.
Okay. So, I got mad at airplanes for a while. So again, I was living in New York and I'd fly back home for, you know, holidays and stuff and sometimes. And I would, but then, you know, they started the scanner things, and for a while before they just moved to it being an outline, they were like taking naked pictures of you. And I was like, listen, they got rid of the leg room. I have to pay for my luggage now. Like, I don't want to take planes. And now you're taking naked pictures of me. Like, it's too much. They don't do that anymore, but, and now I fly. So I started taking buses everywhere, like literally everywhere, Greyhounds. And like, just, and like, there's something that happens on Greyhounds between people, like, cause you're in it for the long haul. So you kind of like develop like relationships with the people you're traveling with. Anyway, we were going from New York to Nashville, but we had a layover in Cincinnati. And there was this woman who had been on the bus with me. She got on in New York with me and was going to Nashville. And, she had, two infant twins with her, right? And they were sitting in her lap because, you know, if they're under a certain age, you don't have to pay for a ticket. They just sit in your lap, and they were very good. They were very well behaved. It was a mostly nighttime bus. They mostly slept. And when we got off the bus at Cincinnati, they wouldn't let her back on the bus. And they were like, you need to buy another ticket. And she was like, no, they're still, like, they're in my lap. They're lap age. And they were like, no, but there's two of them, so you have to buy another ticket. And then she was like, well, why did they let me on the bus in New York? Now I'm in Cincinnati. I don't have any money. I, like, you know, like, I'm broke. I, you know, she's, like, frantically calling her boyfriend, seeing if she can somehow get money. But, like, it's early in the morning on, like, a Sunday. The banks are closed, you know. And so someone at the front of the bus literally just took their hat off, passed it around, and as a bus group, we collected enough money for her to buy a ticket to get to Nashville. And, you know, in a world that's very, like, you're on your own, kid, that was, like, a real, like, restoring faith in humanity type of moment, so.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, what is something on your bucket list that's still on the bucket list?
Okay, here's the thing, I don't think I have a bucket list.
Okay, make one up. Start one now.
Well, no, and I think, honestly, I think this is because my mom died early. Mm-hmm. I grew up thinking that I would also die young, which I've been through a lot of therapy. Like, we've gotten over this now. But, like, what that did was it made it to where it was like, let's just do, like, if you feel like you want to do something, you're going to do it right now, mm-hmm. you know, which meant I had a very crazy 20s. But, you know, but I do think that that really does mean that, I don't know that I have, like, this like, magic list. I think I just want to live my life in a way that, not that having one's bad, I just, me personally. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. What are three things you love about Southminster?
Mm-hmm. I love our little breakout groups. I do. I think that that's very, like, because it puts the emphasis on our journeys and not on, like, a top-down. Not that we don't love Beth, but, like, you know, like, a do whatever I say. I think that that's really important. I really love our brunch, as hodgepodge as it is sometimes. I love it. I think it's all good. And I really love the way that we take care of each other. You know, one of the things that I look for in a church is a church that will help take care of people. You know, when my mom was sick, one of the things that I really loved about the church and Church of Christ at that time was that, like, we never didn't have food. Like, we always had food in the fridge. Even when she couldn't cook for, you know, months at a time, like, there was never a time we didn't have food in the fridge. And I feel like this church would do the same thing. And I really love that.
How can we pray for you in this season?
So I think you all know by now, but Jamie and I are moving. Unfortunately, and I hate it so much that I'm gonna have to leave y'all. Honestly, this church was one of the reasons I held out so long on making the decision, because I am really, I'm going to try not to get too sad. But we have a lot of big decisions to make in the upcoming months. And so if you could pray for us to handle those in a way that both, like, uplifts our relationship with each other and also, you know, uplifts God. I think that'd be important.
I'm going to, before we pray for Amber, I'm going to read her favorite scripture. This is 1 John 4:7-12. Dear friends, Let's love each other because love is from God. And everyone who loves is born from God and knows God. The person who doesn't love does not know God because God is love. This is how the love of God is revealed to us. God has sent his only Son into the world so that we can live through him. This is love. It is not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as the sacrifice that deals with our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us this way, we also ought to love each other. No one has ever seen God. If we love each other, God remains in us, and his love is made perfect in us. Let's pray for Amber. Holy and gracious God, we thank you so much for Amber and for Jamie and all the laughter and love and joy they bring to us. We lift them up to you in this season and ask that you would hold them in the hollow of your hand, guide their thinking, their decision making, give them the peace that passes understanding that only you can give. In Jesus' name, amen. Be seated. I want to invite you to think through your schedule this week and where you might get up to holy mischief with God with unexpected generosity of your time, your kindness, helpfulness, your love, where you might see where a little extra generosity with finances might make a genuine difference to someone. Sometimes. time to think. Let's pray. Giving God, we give you thanks and praise for all your gifts to us. We know that you are the source of every good thing, that light and love come from you. You have created us, and you continue to breathe life into us through the power of your Holy Spirit. You've given us so much, and it is because we recognize the gifts you have given us that we now make plans to give to the work of your kingdom. We dedicate this offering, our plans, our prayers, our financial gifts, to the work of your kingdom here on earth. May they be used wisely and diligently, that your love may be known widely. As we dedicate this offering, we offer ourselves too. Take and use us, that our hands may reach out in service. Our feet may walk the difficult path of reconciliation, and that our words may be words of peace. For this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please stand for the doxology. You may be seated. And would someone go get the kids? They're going to want to be here for our last music part. Thanks, Pete. How can we pray for you all? I bring a prayer request from my family, our family. Our sister-in-law, Cherie, Mark's brother's wife, is having a defibrillation on July 31st. And then open heart surgery on either the 1st or 2nd. So we need to keep Cherie in our prayers. And Bob, wait, we gotta get a microphone. Okay, wait, hold on, Bob. We've got one back there, and we'll get you.
Yeah, we had one come in via the Zoom chat from Lori. She's praying for asking for traveling mercies for her 10-year-old nephew, Nolan. He's riding with his grandpa across the country to California and back. His grandpa is a truck driver and also a Baptist minister, so just praying for traveling mercies, and they are safe as they get to see the country and bond. So.
What a great opportunity for him. And then Bob, we'll get the microphone so we can...
This is a Thanksgiving. Thank you for visiting us yesterday. Beth, as you know, has issues. Mm-hmm. Our Beth has issues.
I do too.
But but when she saw you, up came the head, and it was a nice moment.
Yeah, it was
so
nice.
Thank you for that moment.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, we'll thank God for that moment.
Thank you. I have two. First of all, I think we as a congregation learned a lot about the community and what we need to do, and maybe some things we need to change and some things we need to emphasize. But so thankful that both Beth and Stephanie represented our church in such a respectful and uplifting way.
Thank you.
And my second one is a praise. Our granddaughter, Grace McCleskey, will be 21 Tuesday. So a little amazing, it's going to be legal.
Oh. Are there others? Anissa.
Meredith has been in the hospital for her diverticulitis, and that poor child continues to have leg problems and stomach issues. So if you could just pray for Meredith, I think she's getting out today.
Oh, that's great.
Yes, yeah. Emily knows.
All right. Any others? Okay. Let's go to God together in prayer. Let me get to the right prayer. There will be some moments during our prayer where we'll have some silence, and then you will hear me pray, Lord, in your mercy, and you can respond with, hear our prayer. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy. God, give us all a reverence for the earth as your creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy. Bless all those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loved us. Lord, in your mercy. Comfort and heal all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles. Bring them the joy of your salvation. We especially pray for those whose names and situations are lifted in love this morning. We lift up to you, Cherie, and ask for quick healing and lots of care to surround her as she goes through these procedures. We join Lori in praying for traveling mercies for Nolan and his grandpa as they are on a grand adventure. Lord, we thank you for Annette and Bob and Beth and the joy they bring and the love they bring to us. Thank you, God, for a meeting yesterday where we learned the concerns of our neighbors. We learned of the support of our neighbors. Help us, God, to walk closely with you as we figure out what are our next steps. Lord, we thank you that Grace is 21, and what a miracle that is. And we join with Anissa in praying for Meredith and asking that you would touch and heal as she gets out of the hospital today. Help her to return to her whole strength. For those we are not lifting up by name but holding in our hearts, Lord, in your mercy. Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and on earth, mercifully accept the prayers of these your children and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together with these words, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please stand for our last three hymns.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. When the shadows
standing by my window on a cold and cloudy day when I saw that hearse come rolling for to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken by and by?
I can add anything to that except amen. Let's go have brunch.